Here we're instructed to determine the intervals on which f of x equals x squared minus 4x plus 7 has an inverse function, and then define the inverse function on each of these intervals. So I'm going to start just by showing you a graph of this function, x squared minus 4x plus 7. So here's our function. It's a parabola. And before we answer the original question posed, let's think first of all about whether this function would have an inverse on its unrestricted domain. So remember that for a function to have an inverse in general, it has to be what we call a one-to-one function. Now, graphically, what this means is that the function would pass the horizontal line test. So my function here, just as is, this whole parabola here, does not pass the horizontal line test, right? I can draw horizontal lines, and they're going to touch this function in more than one spot. So that tells me that this function as a whole does not have an inverse. But what we can do, kind of to get around that, is to actually just look at a piece of this function at a time. So basically restrict its domain to a part that is one-to-one, and then we can find the inverse on that interval. And that's what this first sentence is referring to. It tells us to determine the intervals on which this function has an inverse function. So how might I split this up so that it is one-to-one? Well, the most logical way to do this, or the way to get the biggest intervals, is going to be to split it, this parabola up at its vertex. So on the right side of this vertex, I'm going to have a piece of the function that is one-to-one. So this part I just outlined in red here is one-to-one. And then similarly, on the left side of the vertex, I have another piece of the function that's one-to-one. So the way I might write this is as follows. The function f of x equals x squared minus 4x plus 7 has an inverse function on the intervals from negative infinity to 2, and also from 2 to infinity. So I'm splitting this up in this particular example at the vertex of the parabola. And note that if I extended either one of these sides just a little bit beyond 2, I would no longer have a one-to-one function. So I have to split this up at this vertex. Now in this case, my vertex was at a really nice point 2, and I could just read that right off the graph. But what if it wasn't so nice? How would I find the vertex of that parabola? So we're just going to touch on this just briefly. And there are several different ways to find the vertex of the parabola. The way I'm going to show you is the way that's going to be actually useful when we get to the second part of this problem. So there's actually a way to write quadratic functions that's called vertex form. And it looks like this. F of x equals a times x minus h quantity squared plus k. And when the quadratic equation is written in this form, you can read off the vertex, and it's just at point h k. So we're going to actually just take our expression here and rewrite it so that's in this vertex form. And once again, this is just one of many ways to find the vertex, but this form of the equation will actually be what we need to do to answer the second part of the problem anyway. So we will go ahead and do that. So how do I actually get to this form? Well, the way we get to this form is by a process called completing the square. And this is actually a really useful technique to know how to do. So let's go through the steps together. So here's my function, x squared minus 4x plus 7. Now when I'm completing the square, first of all, I want the coefficient of x squared to be 1, which it is in this case already. If it wasn't, then you could factor out whatever that coefficient might be. So then the next thing I'm going to do is I am going to add a special number right here in this blank spot. But in order to keep things balanced and not to actually change the expression, I'm going to subtract off the same number. So how do I find the special number? Well, to find the special number, I'm going to look at the coefficient of the x, which in this case is negative 4. And I'm going to divide negative 4 by 2 and then square the result. Okay, so in this case, that gives me negative 2 squared, which is 4. So 4 is what I call my special number. And so that's what I want to both add and subtract here. So this maybe seems quite arbitrary, but in the next step, you'll see why this works. So if I did this correctly, I should be able to take these first three terms here and factor them as a perfect square. So in other words, this factors to x minus 2 times x minus 2. And then I have a plus 3. So then this becomes x minus 2 quantity squared plus 3. And then I can just see from that that the vertex is at the point 2, 3. So this confirms what we said before. So the answer then to the first part of this question is that these intervals on which the function has an inverse are from negative infinity to 2, and then again from 2 to infinity. So the next part of our task here is to actually find the inverse function on each of these intervals. So let's work through those steps together next. So to do this, to find an inverse function in general, there's kind of a prescribed set of steps to do that. And I'm going to actually go from my rewritten expression here. So the first step is just to write this as y equals f of x. So I'm going to write this as y equals x minus 2 squared plus 3. And then generally the next step that people do is they go ahead and switch the x and the y. So x equals the quantity y minus 2 squared plus 3. And then from here, I am going to solve this expression for y. So then I get x minus 3 equals y minus 2 quantity squared. To get rid of the squared on the right-hand side, I'm going to take the square root of both sides. When I do that, I need to remember to introduce a plus or minus. So I get plus or minus the square root of x minus 3 equals y minus 2, and then I'll just finish by adding the 2 to both sides so that I get y equals 2 plus or minus the square root of x minus 3. Now, I'm sort of done, but not really, because this actually is not a function. If you graphed this, it would have a shape that looked like this, right? It doesn't pass the vertical line test. So this isn't actually a function yet. But there's kind of two pieces included here. There's the 2 plus root x minus 3 and the 2 minus root x minus 3. And each of those is going to be the inverse function on one of the intervals that we mentioned before. So let's start by thinking about what branch of this would be the inverse function on the interval from negative infinity to 2. So because this is the left-hand side of the parabola, it's actually going to be the what maybe you would think about as the negative branch of this inverse function. It's going to be the y equals 2 minus the square root of x minus 3. And we'll verify this all on a graph in a second. So if that doesn't make sense right now, you'll see why in a second. And then on the interval from 2 to positive infinity, we're going to choose the positive branch of this expression here. So the inverse function there would be y equals 2 plus root x minus 3. But it's always a good idea to, if you have the time, to just verify your inverses. You can do that algebraically or you can do it graphically. So let's look at these graphically really quick. So here in my graph, I've changed our window just a bit, and I've isolated the left-hand side of our parabola. That is the interval from negative infinity to 2. And then I've graphed over here the proposed inverse function, 2 minus root x minus 3. Now, if these are indeed inverse functions, what we should see is we should see that they're reflections of each other over the line y equals x, which is this line I just drew here. And it looks like that's true, right? These are reflections of each other over this line. Okay, so it looks like we were right for this first part. Let's check the second part as well. So now I've just shown the right-hand side of the parabola, or that is the interval from 2 to infinity. Should be a bracket here, 2 to infinity. And then I've also graphed the function y equals 2 plus root x minus 3, which is our proposed inverse for this side of the parabola. And we see that it looks correct, right? These look like they're reflections over the line y equals x. So this is how to go about finding an inverse function, specifically when you have to limit the domain of that original function. In this example, we're told to sketch the inverse function of the graph shown below. Now, we're not given an algebraic representation of the function in this case. We're only given its graph. Okay, so we're just going to try to find the inverse function based on the graphical information provided to us. So how do we do that? Well, there's a few properties about the graphs of inverse functions that are going to be helpful for us in this case. The first important thing to realize, or when we graph the inverse function of the function shown here, it's going to be a reflection over the line y equals x. So we should keep that in mind. Another useful fact is that if I have on my original function the point a, b, on my inverse function, I should have the point B, A. That's also really helpful to know. Now, I guess we should note that this function in purple here, and maybe I'll just label this f of x. So my function f of x here is 1 to 1 on the interval shown, so it does have an inverse. Okay, so let's try to actually graph that inverse. I'm going to try, first of all, just to get a few key points in place using this A, B, B, A idea. But in the meantime, we should just always make sure that it looks like things are being reflected over this line y equals x. So I see on my graph here the point 0, 1 right here on my graph f of x. So then I should have the point 1, 0 on the graph of my inverse. Okay, so I should have this point here. So let's see if we can get another point. So let's go to here. So I'm at x equals negative 1, and my y value, let's say, is like 2.7. So then on my inverse, I should have the point 2.7, negative 1. So something right there. Let's try to get a point on the other side here. So it looks like I have the point x equals 2, y equals maybe 0.1. So then I want the point y is 0.1. Let me back up here. So I've got the point 2, comma 0.1. on f of x, so I want the point y is 0.1, or sorry, x is 0.1, y is 2 on the graph of my inverse function. So now that we've got a few key points here, let's try just to connect the dots and draw the shape of the inverse function. So let me try to connect these here. And I'm trying to do this in a way that makes sense with the dots, but then also looks like it's a reflection of my original function. So here we go, and this is a really rough sketch, but this gives us a sense of what this inverse function is going to look like.